got to pull the top of the morning.
This morning? It's St. Patty's Day.
You're really into this.
Dude, I'm so into
it. You should see my apartment right now.
No.
Well, good morning, Streams Church. Am I on? Yes? No? Am I on now? Can you hear me now? Right on. Well, I'm going to invite you to stand today. I want to welcome you. Maybe this is your first time with us, or maybe you've been around a long time. But we're going to get started. I want to welcome you for those who are watching online today. Just a joy and a privilege to have you join us. And I'm sure people are going to be filing in a little bit, but we're excited you're here. I want to read this to you before we get going today. I've been kind of walking through the Old Testament, which I haven't done for years and years, and just in my own personal time. And Israel is looking for their king. Now they've had Moses lead them, they've had Gideon lead them, they've had Samuel lead them, and now they're at the point where they want their own king. And so they go to Samuel, the prophet, and they say, "We want a king." And Samuel's like, "What do you need a king for? You have God. He's your king." And then God's like to Samuel, "You know what? They're not rejecting you, Samuel. They're rejecting me." And this is, so God's like, "Well, if you get a king, just be prepared. Some things are going to change." He said, "Your king is probably going to take your sons and your daughters, and they're going to serve in his army, in his kingdom, and he's gonna take your grounds, and he's gonna reap your harvests, and your king, he's gonna take the best of your fields and vineyards, and he's gonna take a tenth of your grain, and your male and female servants will become his, and he's gonna take the best of your cattle and your flocks, and even you yourselves are gonna be his slaves." But the people refused to listen, and they said, "No, we want our own king. We want a king so that we're like all the other nations. We want a king so that we're no longer separated from the rest of the world. We don't want to be God's chosen people anymore. We don't want to be a peculiar people. We don't want to be set apart. We don't want to be different." And I got thinking, man, you know what? If we're not careful, we can actually be like that. We can be those kind of people. Or like God, we don't want to do it your way anymore. We want to do it the way of the world. So I thought this morning, you know what? We're going to hear some fantastic teaching in a short bit just on God's design and how God wants us living our lives when it comes to his way of biblical sexuality. And we have a guest speaker coming up soon, and you'll hear all about that. But we want to do it God's way. And God's way, how many know that it's often different than the way that the world we live in does things? And so I'm just encouraging you today, just allow the Lord to begin to do a work in each of us so that we're doing it God's way. Who cares if God's way is different than the ways of the other nations and the ways of the world? We're set apart. We're different. We think different. We give different. We serve different. We have desire to serve our King. And so let's do that today. I want to just pray, Lord, we're just inviting you to change our hearts. We're inviting you to change us so that we're less like ourselves and more like you. And so today we give you permission to do a work in our lives that honor you, Lord, that is a blessing to your heart. And so we just want, Lord, to celebrate you today, our King and our Lord. And we give you this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, why don't you find somebody, greet somebody, say hi, high five, handshake, and our worship team will leave us in just a few moments.
Good morning, everyone. Sing with us this morning. Our God has been faithful through all generations. We've all got a story to tell. been faithful, if he's been good, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. And if he's been able, when no one else could, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. Thank you. bow before your throne. In all the elders' cries, their crowns before the Lamb of God in sin. Come on, let's sing that again. In all these things and angels, they bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God in sin. Come on, church, sing this with me. You're worthy of it all.
To rise, oh,
the glory. Oh, you deserve the glory. Oh, you deserve the glory. Come on, church, the Bible says in Revelation that the angels are singing and their incense is rising to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who was, who is, and who is to come. So as we sing this again, can we just lift this up along with all creation, that He is worthy of it all. Let our incense rise to the King of Kings this morning. Day and night, night and day, let incense rise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise.
Teach it to us.
know we need to live like He reigns. We don't serve a dead God. Let all creation know that He reigns, because He does. He reigns. And He calls us to be His people. And a part of that is just coming and doing what we're doing today, meeting as the body of Christ, different parts of this journey to exalt our God, our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let all creation sing, He reigns. He reigns because He does. And He wants to reign your life and my life and our lives because He can. He knows how to run our lives better than we do. So when we come and worship Him and exalt Him, we're doing exactly that. We're proclaiming the name of Jesus is above all names. And so, Lord, today as we gather in this place, Lord, we thank You that we can come freely, yes, without any sort of persecution, without any sort of consequence, Lord, to meet at a time of the week like this where we come and we exalt You. And Lord, we thank You for that freedom. We thank You, Lord, that we can come and gather as Your church, Lord, and exalt Your name. And so, Lord, set a fire within us, each one of us, to do just that, to live each day, Lord, as You are King. God, we're not kings, we're not queens, we're not in charge of this life, Lord. We recognize You are. And we submit our ways to Yours. We decrease, Lord, so that You will increase. And so, Father, as we move on with our time today, Lord, we pray that You will be lifted high, that this is all about You. And, Lord, we pray that You would change us so that we will become more like You, Lord, to walk in Your ways and to put You first in our lives. And so, Lord, this is all for You today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, you may take a seat. And we're just excited to be here today and to worship with each other. And as I mentioned earlier, some of us, we're in different parts of this journey. Some have been doing this for a long time. Others maybe just brand new at Christianity, or maybe brand new at exploring what God can do in our lives. And He's first. And so we want to just extend a huge welcome to you, each one of you that are here today. If you are brand new, and in front of you, you see there's a card that says, I'm new. If you're okay filling that out, putting a name, a phone number, an email address, we're not going to solicit you, track you down, any of that. But we just would love to connect with you and answer any questions that you may have. Or maybe you have some questions for us. We'd be honored to try to answer those for you. If you do fill one of those out before you leave today, just at the bottom of the steps on your way out, there's a little information desk there. If you just want to pass it in, we'll give you a little gift just to say thanks for hanging out with Streams Church this Sunday morning. And so if that's you, just a warm welcome to you today. Lots of things going on. We're going to have a guest speaker in just a few moments. So I'm not going to talk too much about what's coming up this week. Friday evening, we have a seminar, a session, a teaching time for all of you who are parents, grandparents, guardians, or maybe not even yet parents, but you just want to know, how do I navigate my child or my, that one that I'm overseeing or part of their life in a world like this when it's so complicated? So you'll hear more about that. And then next Saturday morning from 9 to 2, we're going to have a time for all of us guys to get together and just explore what a healthy life looks like when it comes to sexuality and exploring life, doing it God's way. And so, again, we'll talk more about that coming up shortly. We have a week of fasting starting on March. I almost went into April too quick, but March 25th to the 31st, you'll see it there. And we just invite you to talk more about that next Sunday as we kind of begin that. But week of fasting, so you can fast food, you can fast technology, you don't even have to do it. But I want to challenge you, if you're in that place of life and you're like, God, I just want to hear Your voice, I want to go deeper with You, then we talked about this a number of months ago, how important and vital fasting is. It's something that we don't even talk about, we don't even consider, but it's so important to our journey with Christ. And so we invite you to partner with us as a church to explore that. Maybe it's one day, maybe it's the whole week, but we're inviting you to somehow give up something to God just to go deeper with Him. And so talk more about that next week. Good Friday service, obviously coming up 10:30. Easter morning, we're going to have a light breakfast prepared. That's coming up very quick. We're going to have baptisms that morning. So we have a couple of you that want to be water baptized. Maybe there's others here that you have not yet been water baptized. You identify as a follower of Jesus, but not quite yet have you been water baptized. And the Bible instructs us to do that, and so we want to give you opportunity to be baptized in water Easter morning. We're taking all kinds of Easter egg donations as you what came in. You'll see on the desk downstairs, there's a basket there. Bring in some, chocolate eggs and anything that you find that we can be a part of a huge Easter egg hunt. So we want our kids leaving this place on Easter Sunday with lots of goodies. And so if you can contribute by donating some of those, that would be fantastic. Take one of these. You'll find them down on the information desk. Maybe there's somebody, I shouldn't say maybe, we all have people in our lives that do not know Jesus. Would you give them one of these? I'm sure there's somebody in your life that trusts you, that if you were to hand them one of these, they wouldn't think you're crazy. They would probably think, man, this person cares about me. And it just talks about what's going on Easter Sunday. What a great Sunday to invite somebody who doesn't have a church, who doesn't have anything, maybe even identity with Jesus Christ. Would you invite them to this? It talks all about times and light breakfast and the service times. So take one of those and give them to somebody that could use one. Also want to give you opportunity today to give. You can see many ways to do that on our screen there. E-transfer, streamschurchgiving@gmail.com. There's a debit terminal in the back. There's envelopes. There's our website. There's all kinds of ways to do that. And we just say thank you for being so generous as we move forward as a church. I still think we're in somewhat of a rebuild. We really are. And you know, you've seen some rough days, but I believe God is doing something new and he's establishing a core group. And we're just excited that you're a part of that as we grow as a church, as we just make a difference outside these walls. Because it's not about what goes on inside of here. It's about how we're equipped to take what we learn to bring it outside so that people can be influenced by the good news of Jesus Christ. And so thank you for your generosity. We're going to take a little break. If you have children with you today, there's a ministry for them, birth to preschool, up our stairs there. There'll be someone in that ministry. We have a ministry downstairs. And if you have children that are kindergarten to grade 5, grade 6, there's a ministry for them downstairs. And we invite you to have your kids go to those areas. For the rest of you, hang out here for a few moments. For those watching online, we're taking a little short break. Say hi to somebody, bring your kids to their ministry area, and we'll be back with the remainder of our morning in just a couple of moments. All right. All right. We're going to invite you back to your seats. It looks like most of you are there, and if you're not, we'll give you a few moments. Well, we're thrilled and blessed and privileged to have our guest speaker, Matt Cline, with us today from Restored Ministries, a ministry I think you might have started, Matt, and it's what Matt does. And we're just excited for him to come and share today. And very interesting, I cheated a little bit and looked at some of his slides, and today he's talking about, maybe in way more detail than I did last week. You remember last week, and we hadn't even talked about this, I mentioned to you a little bit about the story of Amnon and Tamar, you know, the brother and sister, or the brother and sister-in-law, and she was Absalom's sister, and how, you know, the tragedy of what he did to her, and how all that stuff. And today you're going to maybe hear a little bit more detail about that whole situation. I just thought, God's amazing how he just maybe wants us camped here for just a little bit longer to hear what really went on. And so Matt's going to get up and talk to you about, you know, what God's put on his heart today. And then maybe, Matt, if you can even mention this Friday evening and Saturday, where we're going with this. We think this is so massively important for our lives. And so without saying much more, Matt, why don't you come up? Let's give him a hand, and he's going to share.
I was playing. I was on this hockey team and not really doing much. And there, I was little. All my teammates were little. And then there was this big guy, like way bigger than all of us, and he's just crushing it, like dangling everybody and scoring goals. And I remember we won the game. And at the end, we all crowded around at the bench. And this big guy, we all crowded around him. And it was Jesus in this dream. And Jesus, I was on Jesus' team. And he won the game for us, but we were all on the same team. And it's like, man, this is so much less pressure than Brent Sutter used to put on me. Jesus just does everything, man. And we were last in the league. With Jesus, we win. All the pressure put on us as players. Isn't that a good symbolism, though? A good story of life in Christ. We just get the victory with him. He does it all, and we just get to be a part of it. Such a cool picture. And so with sexuality, it's the same thing. You know, so many of us, we want to grind it out. We want to do the right thing. We want to work and have self-control and discipline, and we want to do things in the way that we think is right. But sometimes we don't even know what that way is. And so a lot of us, we know that porn is bad. We know that porn is not good, and there's this moral compass that we see this through, and we shouldn't watch porn, and we know this. But porn freedom can sometimes be an idol. Because we think, if we get free of porn, then I'll be good. But what about the other sexual brokenness in the world? What about just husbands and wives who don't communicate well, and there's a lack of sexual intimacy there? What about not honoring the Lord in our sexual part of our lives? There's this picture of sexual living and this perspective that we can have on sex that brings the Lord into it that sometimes we miss. And so I want to talk about, let me get the slide up if it's going to get up there. All right, next one. Keep coming. Jesus, I need you. Come on, there we go. All right, see, you call on Jesus and it all works out. This is the picture. But we forget sometimes the covenant nature of sex. And God has this covenant with us that he's established that is never breaking. It's till death do you part. It's till the end of the world that he's established. He's like, I'm not going anywhere. And in the same way, sexual relationships are never supposed to end. That's why sexual relationships hurt so much when it's done outside of marriage and then it ends. It was never supposed to end because sex is this thing that consummates the relationship on earth that most closely mirrors the covenant we have with him. But what we do with sex is we think on an earthly plane. We don't remember to bring him into it. So in Matthew 5:27, it says, Jesus says to them, he says, you have heard, or you guys say that you shall not commit adultery. But next verse, 28, But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman lustfully has committed adultery with her in his heart. And so he brings both the mind and the heart into it, and it's not just the behavior. But I would submit to you that there's something else that we're missing. Because when we think of the mind and the heart, we're still thinking on an earthly plane. We're still thinking human-to-human relationships. So in Deuteronomy 5, is given the Ten Commandments, and it says, in verse 3, it says, it's not with others that God made this covenant, but with us. And then in verse 8, it says, don't make for yourself an image of anything in the form of, don't make for yourself an image of anything in heaven, okay? Get past my stuttering and we'll get it. Who's in heaven? God's in heaven. Who's in the image? Who's in the image of God? We are. So when we lust after someone and he says it's committed adultery with them, naturally we're in a covenant relationship with him. And so it's committing adultery against him. Like if I'm in a covenant relationship with my wife, which I am, and I go outside of that, it's with someone else, but I'm committing adultery against the one I'm in covenant with. And so what Jesus is doing, he's saying, don't think just on an earthly plane. I want you to bring me into your sexuality and have such an awareness of my presence and my beauty and my glory so that it totally warps and changes the way that we view sexuality. So there's a tale of two stories here. And with Tamar and Amnon, I want to read a lot of the story, and I'll just kind of give some teaching on the view that Amnon had towards sexuality. And this view that he had is the same view that a lot of us have. It's the view that the world promotes. And it gets into the church. It gets into our thinking. And sometimes we can even view the Bible through this lens of Amnon, through this lens of the world, and we think we're doing the right thing, but there's the next level of bringing God and an awareness of his presence into our sexuality. Now, I want to say, this might trigger some people. Tamar got abused. She got sexually abused by her half-brother. There's a lot of hurt. There's a lot of hurt in this room. There's people who have been sexually abused. There's people who have been in sexual sin. There's wives and husbands and kids who have been hurt by the sexual sin of people in their family. And so I want to just give that caution and say that, hey, I'm not here to just trigger you and have things be bad in your heart, but at the end, you're going to see, stick it out to the end. God's glory is good. It's for you. He's about redemption and about restoration. He's about speaking life and beauty into you, even when there's been hurt. And so I don't want it to trigger anybody, but I know that there's been hurt in this room, as there is in every single room that I go to. So in 2 Samuel 13, it says, now Absalom, David's son, had a beautiful sister whose name was Tamar. And after a time, Amnon, David's son, loved her. And Amnon was so tormented that he made himself ill because of his sister Tamar. For she was a virgin, and it seemed impossible to Amnon to do anything to her. Now, isn't it interesting that it says it was impossible for him to do anything to her? To her. Because Scripture, doesn't it talk about crucifying the desires, the sinful desires of your flesh? Doesn't it talk about glorifying God in our body? Doesn't it talk about, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God? When we see the image of God in people, we don't take advantage of that. We're like, man, that person, that girl, she's beautiful. Yeah, that guy, man, he's handsome. But I'm not going to do anything to them because our sexual desires are supposed to be for them, for the pleasure of our spouse, for intimacy, serving them in the way that they love. This view of doing things to other people totally takes out the Lord, totally takes out seeing them as a person and the beauty that God has put in them, and it totally takes out the godliness in you out of the equation. Amnon thought it was impossible to do anything to her, and his whole thinking was about what he wanted, so much so that it made him ill. And so many people, there's temptations to watch pornography. There's temptations to masturbate. How many of you ever heard that on a Sunday morning? there's temptations to go outside of our marriage or to be promiscuous as a single. And all we think is like, hey, there's this object of our affection. I want to do something to that person. We think about ourselves, but we don't think about the value and what it's going to do to that person in the long run. We think short term. And when we're so caught up in this, it makes us sick. So many guys are like, you know what? If I don't give in, I'm just not going to sleep at night. I'm so caught up in this temptation. And the only way to get peace is to give into this. We feel sick because we're focused on the temptation. We know in our heads morally we shouldn't give in, but all we're thinking about is the pleasure that we want. We don't know how to invite the Lord into it so that he can change the way that we think and change the way that we're feeling in our heart. The world says, these are the positions that you need to engage in for your own pleasure. The world says you should test drive the car before you buy it. But people are not cars. People are not cars. Cars are depreciating assets. We appreciate. We get better. We get more and more godly. We want to continually love. We want to continually receive love. We want to continually grow in who we are in Christ. We are appreciating. We're valuable. There's nobody, nothing on earth that's as valuable as us. And then people, the world equates us as people to cars. Just test drive them. Just see what they're like. You know, sexual relationships are supposed to appreciate. They're supposed to get better. There's studies out there that say the best sex starts to happen around year 20 to 25 in marriage, and then hopefully continue on from there. Now, if you think about the age of that, you're 20 to 25 years married, you've gone through a lot, you've figured things out, you've communicated if we're doing things well, and we're not letting bitterness and resentment get in the way. Sex gets better as we go, but what does porn show? What does the world show? Man, like if you have six-pack abs and you have the right sexual organs of the right size, male and female, like that, man, you're gonna be a sex object. But typically, those bodies, the stars in porn, the ones featured in movies, they're younger. They're in their 20s, they're teens sometimes, they're in their 30s. They're not the ones more experienced in marriage. And so the portrayal of sex in this world is all about physical. It's all about what can that person do for me? Imagine if that person was the one that satisfied me, then I'd feel good. It's this body image that is unrealistic in this world. And the Lord is saying, no, people, sex lives are supposed to get better over time because it's about serving one another, not what they can do for you. So it says, but Amnon had a friend whose name was Jonadab, the son of Shimeah, David's brother. And Jonadab was a very crafty man. Now, isn't it interesting that he was a crafty man? And in Genesis 3:1, it says, now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. More crafty than any other beast. Jonadab was a crafty man. He was crafty. And when we're so focused on our lust, what do we think about? Who do we listen to? What voices do we allow to speak into our lives? Because when the church has been silent and our parents don't know how to talk about sex, which is why parents, grandparents, you have to come on Friday night. It's important to know how to raise us up, raise the kids up in the way that they should go. When the messaging of the Bible, of the Lord, is not present, the voices that we listen to are crafty. No, but it's just my buddy. It's just my buddy, but how do you know he's not influenced by the snake? How do you know that Satan is not behind that article that you're reading? A guy a couple weeks ago, I was speaking at a church, and he came up to me and he said, hey, I disagree with you on one thing. I think that masturbation is good. See, there's this article here. I just pulled it up on my phone. Look, it says masturbation is healthy. And so I asked him, who wrote that article? Well, I don't know. What's the value of that person? What are the values of that person that wrote that? I don't know. What's your theology on masturbation? I don't know. I said, do you see your problem? You don't know what the Bible says, and you're listening to somebody that you don't even know what's behind that intent, what's behind that article. The crafty messages of this world, they make sense. It's why it works. And so we have to be so rooted and grounded in what the Lord says, in biblical sexuality, so that when there's lies that come, we're like, I know that's a counterfeit. I know that's not real. This man was saying to me, but I'm single, and he's an older guy. Like, I'm single, and I've never been married, and what option do I have?
I was able to say to me, you have an option of being so intimate with your Father, so intimate with Jesus that he can satisfy you, that you know how to call on him, that he can satisfy your heart and your body in a way that nothing else can. How do you feel when you engage in this? He says, I feel sad. I feel sad because it reminds me that I've never been in a relationship and I want it. And so I said, brother, why do you do that to yourself? The fruit of that is not good. The fruit of that creates sadness, creates this longing where you just crave this thing. You make yourself ill because you're so focused on it, forgetting that God wants to satisfy your desires. But Satan's crafty, right? He's crafty, like, hey, she's not giving you sex, husbands. She's not giving it to you. You have sexual needs, the enemy tells us. You have sexual needs. But if we have needs, doesn't that have authority over us? Isn't this a message of the world that we all have sexual needs, especially men? You've got sexual needs. And women, yeah, there's emotional connection. Like, sex is emotional for you guys and physical for men. And I get married and I'm like, but you know what? Like, I like the physical. I like the emotional connection. I like the spiritual connection. And my wife does too. Like, there's all three parts there. We're spirit, soul, body. And all of it is for us in sex. We don't have these sexual needs that the world says, like, baby, come on, I need it. It's been too long. You were on your period. You're pregnant. Like, it wasn't happening. I got needs. Come on. And whose fault is it? It's the woman's fault that the man's needs aren't being satisfied. Married or single, it's like, man, but God gave me these needs. It's his fault. Now, when the crafty serpent deceives Adam and Eve, what does Adam say when God comes? Hey, Adam, where are you? Did you eat that fruit? Did you eat from that tree? What did Adam say? But God, it's the woman that you gave me. It's the woman that you gave me. It's her fault. It's your fault. I've got sexual needs. She's not satisfying it. You gave them to me. We're total victims. We're dead in the water if this is our reality. No wonder we have to go to sexual sin. We have to know the craftiness, the deceit that the enemy has practiced for generations. We have to know God's truth, that he calls us to be more than conquerors. He calls us to have authority and to not give in to the lies of the enemy. So verse 4, and he said to him, O son of the king, why are you so haggard morning after morning? Will you not tell me? Amnon said to him, I love Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister. Jonadab said to him, lie down on your bed and pretend to be ill. And when your father comes to see you, say to him, let my sister Tamar come and give me bread to eat and prepare the food in my sight that I may see it and take it from her hand. In verse 6, it says, so Amnon lay down and pretended to be ill. Isn't this interesting that the crafty voice was exactly the voice that Amnon listened to? Whatever the craftiness said, man, that makes sense. Then I won't have to be ill. I could give in because my stress is just so overwhelming from work. My stress is so overwhelming. I feel so alone because nobody loves me in the way that I want. These sexual experiences that I've wanted, man, I've wanted them for years. I've never experienced them. We feel ill. Well, you know what, though? You could go to a massage parlor. You could go to a massage parlor. Like, your body, you're feeling stiff right now. You need a release. You could go to this, and you could just relax, right? And we hear these words, okay, that actually sounds good. And we find ourselves doing exactly what the crafty voice tells us makes sense in the moment. Amnon did exactly what his crafty friend told him to do. It says, when the king came to see him, Amnon said to the king, please let my sister Tamar come and make a couple of cakes in my sight that I may eat from her hand. Then David sent home to Tamar, saying, go to your brother Amnon's house and prepare food for him. So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house where he was lying down. And she took dough and kneaded it and made cakes in his sight and baked the cakes. And she took the pan and emptied it out before him, but he refused to eat. And Amnon said, send out everyone from me. So everyone went out from him. What is the enemy's trick? What is the enemy's scheme in our sexuality? You know, I have to whisper to this person something that's going to make them feel good. Just pretend that you're sick. Just lie down. You're going to get served. People are going to come and serve you. You don't have to serve anybody right now. You don't have to serve anybody. Just pretend. Now, think about it. He wasn't sick. He could have been serving people. He could have been a blessing to those that God had given him. But instead, he was so sick because of his desire and so pretend to be ill. and just have someone come and serve you. Have porn serve you. Have that person at work serve you, that person that you're looking for affection from, have them serve you. Hey, you know what 1 Corinthians 7 says, the crafty voice says to us? It says, hey, you have authority over your spouse's body. That body is not for them, it's for you, come on. And it makes sense to us because we're not rooted. We're not grounded in the truth. But in what it's actually meaning in 1 Corinthians 7, where we have authority over each other's body in marriage, is that we have the authority to serve them in a way that they love like nobody else gets to serve. I get to give my wife foot rubs. Nobody else gets to do that. She loves it. I don't like foot rubs. They're uncomfortable. They hurt. I'm like, okay, but I like other stuff. I like head rubs. I like back rubs. Like, she can give me that. Nobody else gets to. Sexually, you get to serve one another with your bodies because in a way that nobody else gets to, because you have that authority. You have that place of servanthood. God comes and he serves us. He uses the authority over us to serve us and draw us into his love. But if we don't return it, he doesn't get offended. If we don't return the love in the way that he calls us to, he doesn't get mad like, man, I'm so sick of these people. I'm going to go make a covenant with someone else. No, he loves. He loves. So then we believe this voice and we go into isolation. Everybody get away from me. Everybody go. Hey, I'm going to close my door. I'm going to close my door. I'm going to lock the bathroom door. I'm going to go into my office and turn the computer so that nobody can see. And when they ask me what I've done, I'm going to prepare a meeting or a message for what I was doing in this meeting that I was just going to have. It was just a work meeting. And we prepare this isolation both physically and in our souls where we begin to hide. And we say, nobody come in. Nobody gets to know what I've done. The enemy loves isolation because it's a trap that sets us up to fall and get trapped into sexual sin. We have to be aware of the schemes of the enemy. The fiery darts that come at us. It says in Ephesians to wear the armor of God, the breastplate of righteousness. No, I am a righteous son of God, daughter of God. I am righteous in his sight because of what Jesus did. And when I have my breastplate of righteousness, yeah, these lies come. They sound good. The fiery darts come. But they bounce off of me. They fall on the floor because they don't stick. I know the truth. I know who I am and what God's word is for me. Verse 10, it says, then Amnon said to Tamar, bring the food into the chamber that I may eat from your hand. And Tamar took the cakes she had made and brought them into the chamber to Amnon, her brother. But when she brought them near him to eat, he took hold of her and said to her, come, lie with me, my sister. She answered him, no, my brother, do not violate me, for such a thing is not done in Israel. Do not do this outrageous thing. As for me, where could I carry my shame? And as for you, you would be as one of the outrageous fools in Israel. Now, therefore, please speak to the king, for he will not withhold me from you. Where can I carry my shame, she says. As for you, you would be a fool. Let me speak to the king. There's herself, there's the other, there's the king. Sex is meant to do four things. It's meant to honor God primarily, serve our spouse. It's meant to please our heart. It's meant to please our body. It's meant to be pleasing for us. And it's supposed to produce fruit. But sin perverts it all. It perverts every single one of those. Because where could I carry my shame? She's thinking long term. She's thinking after. What is Amnon thinking of? He doesn't think long term what it's going to do. He's thinking of having her for himself in the moment. He's thinking of this for how long, we don't know, but for a long time made himself ill because all he's thinking is the sexual experience that he wants to have. He's not thinking long term of the fruit that this is going to produce. He's not thinking of the value that she has or how would this honor God. But she is such a woman of God that even in this time where she's about to get raped, she's thinking of God because she knows the power of covenant and sex and that God is all about it. Her mind is so full of God's truth that she's going, this is a sexual experience. I've never had one, but yet I know that this is powerful. I know that if I engage in porn, it's going to warp my mind. I know that these things that I've done or these things that the enemy wants me to do sexually, they're going to produce bad fruit. They're going to hurt me. Amnon doesn't think that. And honestly, neither do we. We think momentarily. We think in the moment. A lot of pastors, and I give these two guys credit because they want to do this. They want to have a day on Saturday, not just for porn addicts, but for men to have sexual health and a biblical understanding of sexuality. And we'll go deeper than we are today. But I give these guys credit because a lot of pastors are like, this is too uncomfortable. It's just not my personality. And they think about them. They don't think about, but what am I neglecting to tell my people? How about what God did? And he talked about sex in the Bible, and so I will honor him with this message. When we think about sex, we go, this is uncomfortable, this is awkward, and we think about ourselves. We think about raising our kids and like, well, I gave them the sex talk, right? Like that should be good, and they can hopefully learn something from this book I'll maybe give them. Hopefully their youth pastor will talk to them and they'll learn because it's a bit uncomfortable. But all we think about is us. We get uncomfortable and then we go silent. We become isolated. Do you see how it's not just about porn? It's about the craftiness of the enemy telling us lies that make us comfortable hiding in an isolation. So sexual brokenness becomes rampant and he gets hold of our souls. The truth is so beautiful. The truth is so good. And we get to be messengers of the new covenant, ministers of the gospel. And somebody said to me, hey, we should sexually disciple people. I said, no, we should disciple people. And sexuality is part of that. This is part of living the Christian life, is understanding something that's at the consummation, like the pinnacle of consummating the covenant relationship we have that mirrors the one with God. This stuff is powerful. But he would not listen to her. Amnon would not listen to her. And being stronger than she, he violated her and lay with her. Isn't it wild? You think about how long he made himself ill, dreaming of the day that he had her, thinking like, this is impossible that I get her, but I'm not going to surrender it. I'm not going to lay it down. Made himself ill, wasn't rooted in the truth. And so the crafty voice came, and what did it say? He listened to Jonadab. He did exactly what the crafty friend told him to do. But the moment God's truth and an honorable woman came and shared God's truth to him, the moment that was in his presence, no, he wouldn't listen to that. Because we've been so full of the lies of the enemy. And so we might think we're doing the right thing, but what are the lies that we don't even know we're believing? What are the lies of the enemy, of the world, that make sense, that we think is good? God is saying, are you going to listen to me? Are you going to know how to surrender things? Because I want so much for you. I want good sex for you in marriage. I want it to prosper for you. I want you to know that you're more than conquerors. And as a single person, your sex drive is not to be put to death. When you're married and your spouse isn't having it, your sex drive is a gift. It's beautiful because it points us to intimacy with Jesus. So many of us think that the end goal of our sex drive is a sexual experience. Actually, the end goal of our sex drive is intimacy with Jesus. Because whether we're engaging in it or not, we're married or single, it doesn't matter. We have this sex drive that points us to a need for him so that we can learn to control our bodies in a holy way. When we think about the end goal of our sex drive being sexual release and that's not happening, then we put to death our sex drive, or at least we try to. We think that we should, and then when it comes alive and it's perverted, we beat ourselves up. But the reality is scripture doesn't say to put the drive to death. It says put sin to death. Know that the beauty is powerful. Know that the beauty is good. We need to know that God gave us these attractions, these desires for a good thing to point us to him and so that we could learn how to be more than conquerors. When God speaks these truths to you, do you listen? Do you listen or do you go, no, I've been fed for decades the lies of the world. So much so that they make sense to me and I believe them, that when I hear God's truth, I just shut the door. I just push it aside. This is why we're in trouble, right? Like this is why as a culture we're in trouble. We push God out of the schools. We push prayer out. We don't talk about sex in church. We don't talk about sex in our homes. When we do, it's often about don't watch porn and don't have sex till you're married. But what else is there? Is there talk about how to steward your body in a way that's holy and honors God? Is there talk about being sanctified in all things and that your sexual energy, your sexual drive can be the pivotal point of you learning sanctification? 1 Thessalonians 4 says it's God's will that you be sanctified, so avoid sexual immorality. I'm like, wow, that's powerful, because it doesn't say avoid drunkenness, avoid these different sins. It goes right to sexual immorality. His will that you be sanctified. And I can tell you from my life, when I got called out of pornography, the Lord said, hey, Matt, I want to use you. I want to do great things through your life, but you've got to get pure. You have to deal with this. I thought that it was the purity in my behavior that he was speaking to. And what I learned over time was that he drew me into this intimacy, and he started healing my heart and healing my mind and renewing the way that I think so that I could then be a healthy person overall. I got married. I had my kids. The ministry started bearing fruit. And I'm like, man, all of this stuff happened when the Lord called me out of sexual immorality. This is not just because Matt has a ministry dealing with this stuff. This is the same for countless people that we've worked with. Countless people. One guy for 20 years had this dream to start a business, and he was watching porn secretly. He had an emotional affair on his wife. He had this dream. He knew that he should quit porn, but he kind of just dismissed it in his life, and he hid it. And the lies of the enemy, like, you can't tell your wife this stuff. And he would hide, and he would hide his text messages. And one day it came out, because it always does. And all of a sudden he got free. He got healthy in his heart. He forgave people for the trauma that he went through as a young guy. And what then happened? This business that's not even about sexual things started to take shape in his life. A 20-year dream that was dead because sexual perversion was rampant. When we deal with sexual immorality, it has an overflowing effect that impacts everything in our lives. Because for me, intimacy with Jesus was the thing that got me out of it. But that intimacy with Jesus was also the thing that started bearing fruit in my life. We can't bear fruit apart from him. We can do nothing apart from him. And we can't really truly get sexually healthy apart from him. And so when people talk about, like, I'm on this recovery journey and trying to recover from my sexual sin and trying to quit my sin, I'm like, man, you're missing the point. Because the point is freedom in Christ. The point is healing in your heart. The point is intimacy with Jesus. And when you get that established, he will bring you out and he will transform you. Somebody asked me a few months ago, hey, have you healed from your porn journey, from your porn addiction? And it threw me off. I'm like, healed from a porn addiction? I've never thought that way in my life. And so I said, I don't really think that way. I live a lifestyle of God healing my heart. I pray, God, come search me, know my heart, test me, see if there's anything in me that's offensive. Lead me in the way everlasting. It's Psalm 139, 23 and 24. Search me, God. This is the way that we want to live. But when we're stressed and when we're hurting and when we're alone and we just continually go to sexual sin, we never face the stuff that's causing us problems. We become emotionally and spiritually immature, even as senior citizens who have been in the church and been elders and pastors for decades. But we're spiritually immature because we don't know how to deal with the stresses, because we continually escape into what feels good. We blame things for our behavior, but we never grow. Then Amnon hated her with a very great hatred, so that the hatred with which he hated her was greater than the love with which he loved her. He loved her to the point that he was ill, and now after this experience, he hated her more than that. This hatred is insane. And the people that engage in sexual sin, we know this all too well. You're enticed by it. You engage in it. You watch pornography. You go to the massage parlor. You whatever it is, and the moment you're done, there's just this overwhelming feeling of guilt and shame, and it carries with you for days or weeks or years. The temptations might be a few minutes or a few days, but the guilt, it lasts forever, unless the grace of God comes. Amnon didn't let this come, and so this hatred started to ruin his life and affect how he lived. And so Amnon said to her, get up, go. But she said to him, no, my brother, for this wrong in sending me away is greater than the other that you did to me. But he would not listen to her. He called the young man who served him and said, put this woman out of my presence and bolt the door after her. See, when we're unwilling to live in the grace of God, the presence of God wants to come and bring us to this higher level of living. Yes, you've wronged me, Amnon, But now that we're in covenant, now that we've attached ourselves in body, soul, and spirit, if you send me away, that's even worse. Now we're together. God's presence was there, but he wanted nothing to do with it because he was all about the sexual sin, but now the hatred that he wasn't willing to receive grace over. Bolt the door, send her away. I want nothing to do with this truth of God. And we do this subtly, guys. We do this because we feel we need to beat ourselves up and live in regret. We feel like it's justified and it makes common sense that we live in guilt, that we condemn ourselves, that we suffer the consequences of what we've done. And sometimes, you know, we say that common sense is not common, right? I would suggest to you common sense is too common in the church. Because we sin and we beat ourselves up, and the grace of God all the while is trying to get in there, knocking on the door of our heart. And what are we doing? No, get that away, because I need to beat myself up for a bit. The grace of God does not make sense. And so the common sense that we live with shuts the door to grace entering our lives. It makes sense to beat ourselves up because of what we've done. But the grace of God does not make sense. We have to welcome it in if we ever want to live free. So it says, now she was wearing a long robe with sleeves. For thus were the virgin daughters of the king dressed. So his servant put her out and bolted the door after her. And Tamar put ashes on her head and tore the long robe that she wore. And she laid her hand on her head and went away, crying aloud as she went. And her brother Absalom said to her, has Amnon your brother been with you? Now hold your peace, my sister. He is your brother. Do not take this to heart. So Tamar lived a desolate woman in her brother Absalom's house. See, when we think about what we could do to people, we wreck them. When we watch porn without a thought of the sexual abuse that these people are suffering, the drug addiction that they're in, the suicidal thoughts that are daily in their lives because they're being manipulated and raped on set, manipulated by producers, separated from their families. They have no support system. They have no leverage. They've been filmed naked on screen and told if they run that their whole family and friends, they're all gonna get sent this video. We think that, hey, they're probably enjoying it. We think about what it's doing to us, but we don't think about how it's gonna cause them to live this desolate life, full of pain, walking away, crying, after the experience. There's porn stars that have told me, one porn star that has told me, that there's girls that are crying on set and they just don't film the face. But sometimes they can't get away from it. And the tears are there, but we don't see it. This girl said, this was never my experience, but I would leave set crying all the time because of the pain of what I had just gone through. What do we do when we watch this stuff? It's just, man, this is good for me. This is what I need right now. I have sexual needs. It's my wife's fault. And we think about what it's doing to us. When King David heard of all these things, he was very angry. But Absalom spoke to Amnon, neither good nor bad, for Absalom hated Amnon because he had violated his sister Tamar. When we don't have an awareness of God, either like before our sin, when there's temptations after our sin, just in our sex drive, even if it's not sinful, when we're not thinking of him, our only response when we make mistakes is guilt, condemnation. We get angry. We blame other people. We blame God. We get angry at God thinking, I've been trying and asking you for so long to get me out of this. All the while he's saying, I want you to change the way you think. I want to change your heart. I don't want to enable you to live as a little baby. I don't want to enable you spiritually and take this problem that I'm going to use to grow you into something great. I'm going to use this testimony to lead other people out of Egypt, out of oppression, out of captivity. Trust me in this process and don't get angry at God. Don't get angry at God if we've been struggling for too long. So there's another person. We've focused on none, but Tamar was real too. And so I want to point out some perspectives that she had that were so godly that we can adopt. So in verse 7, I'll just get it up here. All right. So in verses 7 to 8, it says, "Then David sent home to Tamar, saying, 'Go to your brother Amnon's house and prepare food for him.' So Tamar went to her brother Amnon's house where he was lying down, and she took dough and kneaded it and made cakes in his sight and baked the cakes." She was simply doing what she was told to do by the king. A lot of us, we're doing the right things in life. We're doing the right things, and then situations come that trap us. Situations come where we get tempted and we get enticed and we fall. People come and they abuse us, and they awaken something in us that was not meant to be awakened. And we feel so much shame and guilt, and we feel like it's our fault a lot of the time, especially when we've been abused, and we walk away from that going, did I let that happen? Was that my fault? Did I say yes and I don't even remember? We feel like it's our fault, but I want to encourage you that probably you were doing the right stuff in life. God spoke to me in a dream one night. It was the first dream I ever had from him, and I had asked him, "Hey, Lord, can you give me a dream?" And I was also praying, "God, forgive me for what I've done." And in that dream, I was on this golf course, and I was doing the right thing. I was playing the round of my life. And all of a sudden, I ran, and everybody around me was in chaos. And I went to South Common in Edmonton, and I parked my car in the middle of the street, and all the cars were in chaos all around me. And then I went to West Ed, and the security system, the overhead or the speaker system was, "Hey, find this guy, take this guy. Hey, this is where he is." And I kept hiding behind walls and hiding under escalators. And finally, I came out from behind an escalator, and I said to the security guards, "Hey, I'm the guy you're looking for. You can take me in." This dream, the next scene of the dream, I was in the jailhouse, and I said to them, "Hey, could I call my dad before he takes me back to the cell?" And they said, "Yeah, the phone's right there." So I called my dad, and I said, "Dad, you should have seen me on the golf course. You should have seen me." And in a moment, I ran. I don't know why I ran. I was playing the round of my life. I don't know why I ran, but I confessed. I turned myself in, and now I'm in the jailhouse. And my dad spoke to me in the dream, and he kind of laughed, and he said, "It's okay, son. Just get back on track." The next scene of the dream, I'm back on the golf course. Everything is blissful. I'm hanging out with my friends. We're all in peace. And I see the sun, this big sun in the sky, with the face of God just beaming down on me as if I had never done anything wrong. The dream ended, and it just kind of went gray, and I heard God. I've never had this since, but I heard God speak, and he interpreted the dream. He said, "When you were playing the round of your life, you were exactly where I want you to be in life, and in a moment, you sinned. In a moment, you didn't mean to. I know your heart, but in a moment, you sinned. You made a mistake, and when you sin, other people are in chaos, because what you do matters. What you do has a positive effect on them if you're living obediently to me. But when you sin, when you make a mistake, that has a negative effect on those around you because your life is so valuable and meant to impact. Everybody was in chaos because of your sin. But when you confessed and you called your dad, that was as if you called me. And I forgive you." And I just say, "Get back on track, son. Get back on track." And the end of the dream came when the sun was shining down on me and the face of God is there. And he is looking at me like I had never done anything wrong in my life. And I'm thinking, I literally just sinned. And now you're showing me this? See, it's not common sense to receive the grace of God. Because when we sin, there's so much shame that we bring on ourselves. But God is saying, let that go. Because as far as the east is from the west, that's how far your sin is from you. Like if we hop on a plane and fly to Vancouver and then fly to Tokyo and then fly to wherever else in Asia, and there's all these layovers. That's a bit of a trip. It takes a long time. It's out of our way. It's expensive. And that's the burden, the obstacles that we should have in our life to even consider going and grabbing our shame that he has taken from us. Instead, we sin, and immediately we just take it. We just accept it, and we live with it because I deserve it. Tamar was doing the right thing. She was doing the right thing. She literally went to the king. The king came to her, gave her orders, and she was obeying him. This moment came that wrecked her. I want you to be encouraged that God is not condemning you. If you've committed sexual sin by choice, he still doesn't condemn you. If you've been abused, if you've been violated, if you've been betrayed in your marriage, he is not condemning you. It is not your fault. He's saying, get back on track with me. Don't let these crafty lies come in and take shape in your life. Get back on track with what I have for you, because it's good. Tamar says, such a thing should not be done in Israel. Don't do this wicked thing. And in Ephesians 5, it says to not even have a hint of sexual immorality, for it's improper for God's people. And I heard a commentator, I read a commentator on this passage, and he was saying she probably was talking about it being wicked because they're half siblings. And in Leviticus, it says that a brother shouldn't sleep with his sister. I'm thinking, man, is this missing the point? Because they're not married. This is not a covenantal act that honors God. It's a covenantal act that honors the evil one. And so he's missing it, saying, hey, this shouldn't be done in Israel. It's talking about incest, probably. No, it's talking about any sexual sin that is outside of God's design. And he's saying, this should not be done. And so my question to you is, when you let in these little hints of sexual immorality, when there's lyrics that we listen to in songs and we sing along with them, and it's all about sexual sin, when there's sex scenes in movies and TV shows, and there's these little hints, comedians that we watch that talk about masturbation and talk about cheating on their wives and husbands, and they talk about these things and all the promiscuity and dating culture, and they talk about this, and we continue watching this stuff, we're letting the hints of sexual immorality come into our lives. And I think that our response should be just like Tamar's. This is a wicked thing that should not be done in our world. It should not be part of my life and in our home, because this is a wicked thing in the sight of God. But is that our standard? Or do we just go, you know, that's kind of funny, actually. Like those sex jokes, those dirty jokes that we tell, it's kind of funny. But do we know that in Ephesians 5, it says to not engage in vulgar jokes or crude jokes because it's not proper for God's people, but rather give thanks? In Colossians 2, it says, those who are rooted and established in the Lord are overflowing with thanksgiving. So what a cool thing that God is equating getting rid of the hints of sexual sin with being rooted in Him. Instead of letting these hints in, give thanks in your heart that you don't need to engage in this stuff, that He is sufficient to satisfy, that His beauty is so much greater than anything in this world, and that our sex drive points to Him. Give thanks so that we can get rooted and grounded and established on Jesus Christ in our lives. But she said to him, no, my brother, for this wrong is sending me away, for this wrong in sending me away is greater than the other that you did to me. She's so aware of the power of sex. And not only is she aware of the power of sex, she's concerned that he's going to commit a different wrong, another wrong. She's concerned for the one who abused her. She's concerned for him going, you've already committed wrong. Now we have to be together. She's literally willing to be with him. Now, I'm not advocating if you be abused, don't deal with it and just stick it out. I'm not saying that. But what her mentality is that there's such a powerful connection, a spiritual connection in sex, that once it's there, hey, don't send me away. That's even greater. That wrong is even greater. The power of marriage, the power of sex in that relationship is immense. And no wonder with this covenantal design, God says to us, hey, except for sexual immorality, don't get divorced. I would say abuse too. There's different things that you can look at in scripture, but the most clear one is sexual immorality, because the power that is supposed to form in your lives and the connection is so about the Lord. We bring him into it, and no wonder he singles this out because of the power of it. No wonder then the enemy says, you know what? I'm going to taunt you guys morning and night with temptation. I'm going to taunt you guys morning and night for 40 days, ongoing, saying, you can't talk about this. I'm too big. I'm too scary. What are people going to think if you talk about this? And the Israeli army stands back, and they don't even engage the fight. They don't even engage because they're scared of the giant. And what does David say? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Are you kidding? This guy you're scared of? And we have the power of God, and the battle is the Lord's? And you're scared of this? Sexual sin presents itself as a giant in our world. But you know what that tells me? God is so much bigger than that. It's not hard for him when people take a step take a step into the battlefield for him to do a work in your kids, for him to do a work in the church, to do a work through your story of shame that is now his story of grace in your life. He can do it because he's so sufficient and he wants to do it with us. The power of sex is real. Tamar knew this. And a lot of times, we just think sex is good. Sex is enjoyable, pleasurable. But the reason the crafty voice has come and perverted so much in this world is because of the power of sex. So let's not just think avoidance. Let's think, how could I engage in my sexuality in a healthy, powerful way so that God can do amazing things in my marriage, amazing things in my life, amazing things through me, because the power of sex in me is immense. Now, she was wearing a long robe with sleeves, for thus were the virgin daughters of the king dressed. So his servant put her out and bolted the door after her. And Tamar put ashes on her head and tore the long robe that she wore. And she laid her hand on her head and went away, crying aloud as she went. Don't we feel dirty after we've engaged in sexual sin? It doesn't feel good. This guy a couple days ago was saying to me, hey, thanks for talking about masturbation. We were at this men's workshop that we'll expand on Saturday and go super deep. And one of the guys, another guy, was saying, like, I've never heard this stuff in my life. Thank you for getting us to think differently. So guys, come on Saturday for sure. But this one guy said to me, he's like, my Christian counselor told me that when we have sexual troubles in our marriage, I could just masturbate. And it's totally fine to just take care of yourself. But I wonder where in Scripture it talks about pursue pleasure for yourself in any way, sexual or otherwise. It never does. I wonder where it talks about in Scripture that masturbation is okay. And a lot of times people will say, well, it doesn't say that it's not okay. And I think, but does God not have a thought on it? Does he not think anything of it? I think that Proverbs 25:2, it says, it's to the glory of God to conceal a matter and the glory of kings to search it out. He doesn't say everything outright because he wants it to be intimacy with him. He wants us to have questions and go to him and call to him so he can show us and speak to us these great and unsearchable things, these mysteries of Scripture. And this question about masturbation that's in this world is one of them. A lot of people are not founded on the truth, and so we give in and read articles that maybe this is good for us. But every single positive, godly mention of sex in the Bible is a man and a woman serving each other in the context of marriage. Clearly, solo sex falls outside of that. God doesn't want to treat us like little infants that need to have everything laid out to us clearly. He's saying, if you're mature in me and you seek me for truth, you know what my design is. You know the truth. So the crafty lies of the enemy that come, that doesn't make sense at all. Like if we know 2 + 2 = 4, and somebody, Jonadab, comes like, hey, did you know 2 + 2 = 5? No, it doesn't. No, it's not 5. Like, I know that. I know 2 + 2 = 4. We know the truth, and we have to get founded on his word. She went away crying because she was so broken. We need to get founded on his word, going, you know what? The grace that he has for us is sufficient. There's some brides out there that go, I'm not worthy of wearing a white wedding dress because I've been impure. I've been sexually immoral. I've had sex before marriage. I can't wear a white wedding dress. And I just want to say, yes, you can. With the grace of God, you can do this. He washes you and makes you clean. He wants to heal and restore. And it's not just a momentary thing, but it's this process of long-term getting his truth established in you and healing your heart and changing the way that you think. His grace is sufficient. But those moments where we feel so dirty, it's hard, we're grieving, we're like, this happened to me, I did this thing, I'm crying, I'm suffering. But I want you to be encouraged. Because in James 1:15, it says, then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Amnon, later on, was killed by his brother Absalom because of his sexual sin. He was killed, it brought forth death in his life. But in 2 Corinthians 7, it says, for godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret. Now, how is this possible that we've engaged in sexual sin? We've maybe hurt others. We've deprived our spouse to control the marriage and given them silent treatment, and that's not right. And we've done these things, and when we realize and we're repentant and sorrowful, oh man, God, I can't believe I did this. But how is it possible to live without regret of this stuff? People can go decades in sexual sin, and when they really get a revelation of the grace of God, their regret turns to thankfulness and awe at what God is doing through their lives. I want to say to you, if you've been hurt, if you've hurt others, if you've hurt yourself, your story is not over. If you've come out of it, and it's been years since you committed sexual sin, maybe God is saying, this thing can be revived as a testimony of my grace for other people who need to hear about what you did. Because they need to hear about my grace and my love. People need to know your story of brokenness because it will inspire them to see God working in your life the way that he can in theirs. We can live without regret even though we've done what we've done. And so Tamar was so broken. She's so sad. She's so in grief. She's sorrowful. But her sorrow is good. Too many of us live numb. We're just numb. We don't feel emotion after what we've done. It rapes our soul, sexual sin. It rapes our mind. It's like, man, this thing, like, it is too much. And with trauma, with abuse, we just forget it. We don't want to think about it. We just suppress it. And we don't think about, what is this really doing? The messages of this world, what is it really doing to my life? But when you actually think about it and you grieve it, you grieve that, like me, that 15 years watching pornography. You grieve it. I'm going like, Lord, what could I have done? What could I have done with you? What could I have experienced? What could I have done with my work? What could my relationships have been like? And I remember I was grieving this, and I was saying to the Lord, man, I'm just sad. I'm just sad that I did this. And I felt like the Lord brought to mind, but if you weren't exposed to porn by this one guy, you wouldn't have in mind to pray for him. I want you to pray for his salvation. I'm like, wow, you could redeem it. That whole 15 years, you could redeem it by me praying for that guy. If I went through that, but he gets saved, is that worth it? I don't know. It's at least redeemed where I'm not simply seeing it with regret. The Lord speaks to me, shows me this picture in my mind of me as a young boy in the room that I was first engaging in sin with, in porn. And he speaks to me and goes, man, my call on your life was established even when you were there. Without regret. If you have regret, God wants more for you. He wants healing for you. He wants you to be full of his grace and intimacy with him so that you can do amazing things and he can work through your life. You know, Tamar was so broken, and justifiably, she's hurt. She knows the power of sex. She knows what it does. She knows that it rots our souls. She knows that now there's been this covenantal act and it's being distorted and she's sent away and she's weeping and she's in distress and she lives distraught in Absalom's house and she's there for a long time. But the last reference that we ever hear about Tamar is in the next chapter. It's chapter 14, verse 27. And it says, there were born to Absalom three sons and one daughter whose name was Tamar. She was a beautiful woman. Tamar's niece was named Tamar. The first thing that we ever hear about Tamar, there was a beautiful woman. Her name was Tamar. The last reference that we ever see, Tamar's niece was beautiful, and she was named Tamar. See, the dirtiness, the brokenness, the sin, the guilt, that doesn't have to define us. It doesn't have to linger. What God wants is he wants to take your story, your grief, your sorrow, your brokenness. He wants you to feel it. He doesn't want you to suppress it. He doesn't want you to be numb. He wants you to feel it. Bring it to the surface. Have conversations. Have it exposed like hers was. And realize that God can reestablish the legacy. What he had for me in the beginning, I'm crushing it on the golf course. He's like, just get back on track. What he had for Tamar in the beginning, she was a beautiful woman. And the legacy now of her life is going to go beyond her life in the younger generation. Because Psalm 112 says, the generation of the upright will be blessed. Tamar was upright, the generations moving forward in her family carry her name. And it's the same thing for all of us here. Whatever has happened, whatever has been done, whatever we have done in betraying God, in forgetting to bring him into our sexual sin, in forgetting to remember his grace, whatever we have done, God is going, what I had for you in the beginning, that's not done. That's not over. I still have more for you. I still have work for you to do. You're alive and I love you and I adore you. Yes, you hurt somebody. You hurt your spouse. You hurt your brother. You hurt that person. You violated people. You contributed to porn, the connection between that and sex trafficking. Yes, you did, but that does not define you. My cross defines you. My grace defines you. And because of what Jesus did, it says in Colossians 1, he presents us to the Father as holy, blameless, and above reproach. Isn't that awesome? For all of us, he doesn't see the sin on us. He beams down on us with this face that does not see sin on us because he loves us. I'll just pray, and then Pastor Bill can come up. God, I thank you for your truth, and I thank you that your truth can reside in our hearts and our minds more so and more powerfully than the lies of the crafty enemy. I thank you, Lord, that what we've done does not define us, but what defines us is what Jesus did on the cross. And I pray that that would be real for everyone here. I pray that the message of healthy sexuality, biblical sexuality, that it honors you, that it's about service to another, that it's about pleasing our heart, producing good fruit, Lord. I pray that that message would be one that people here can take and bring into their homes and bring into their relationships. And I pray that for a ripple effect here, moving out from streams, that there would be a stream of revelation that changes Red Deer and changes families and changes people that you have brought into relationship with people at Streams Church. And I thank you for the opportunity to know your word and that no matter what, you wash us clean. And thank you that your grace is sufficient. So I pray right now that where there is brokenness, there's grief, there's sorrow, I pray that you would bring that to mind and that you would bring tears through people's eyes. I pray that there would be a real repentance and a grief that we experience because of what's happened. But I pray that that would be a releasing so that your grace can come and reside in our hearts where there's been brokenness and shame for so long. Thank you that you are sufficient and that you love us so much. In your name, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Matt. Good job. Wasn't that awkward? Hey, you know, I was thinking, you know, a lot of people say that the reason our world is in such a mess is because the family unit is broken. And often the family unit is broken because of sexual sin. I'm willing to bet that the majority of divorces that happen is rooted somewhere in sexual immorality, where there was hints of it that turn into more than hints, that turn into tragedy. And we all have our stories and we can all relate in some way or another. And when I mentioned this to our board back a little while ago, I thought, I've never done anything like this. I've never brought in someone to speak about this, but it's so relevant. It's so now. It's been around forever. And you know, as we talked to the leadership team, you know what? I think we need to talk about this. And maybe for some of us, it's like, well, this is uncomfortable. Yeah, it is uncomfortable because our world has made it uncomfortable. And we think, well, my children are too young to hear this. I'm telling you, if they're not hearing it here, I can guarantee you they're hearing it out there. And, you know, Matt would probably know more of the stats, but I'm hearing stats of like 8 years old when some of our kids are getting involved and addicted to this. And so it does have a purpose to serve. And so it's why we thought, you know what, we need to be healthy as a church because, you know what, we read earlier to open our morning, the Israelite people were like, we want a king, God, we don't want you. We want a king because we want to be like everyone else. And I think God's reminding us we can't be like everyone else. We have to do it his way. And his way is to walk in purity. And his way is to walk in health. And our marriage is flourishing. And not making this about us, but making it about him and serving each other, even within our marriages. And so we just want to say thank you, Matt, for coming and bringing this. And the Lord has put this on your heart, and you're going around to different churches and ministering. And it's not just about a Sunday morning thing. There's seminars, and there's for parents and for men. And we'll be doing that this coming weekend on Friday and Saturday. So please, if you can make this a priority, if you're parents, grandparents, guardians of kids, you have children that you're overseeing, you have influence, would you come out on Friday night and we can just discuss, you know, what it is, how we can help our kids navigate through this messed up world. And then on Saturday, guys, we'll do the same thing. And we just believe God's going to provide healing, God's going to set free, and we're not going to walk in condemnation. And so, we just thought to, what a great opportunity for us to invest into this ministry as a church. And we want to, obviously, bringing Matt here and having him come next week, there's expenses. We want to honor him. We want to honor this ministry. This is how he makes his living, and we think there needs to be more of this in our world, just going against the flows of the world. And so we want to give you opportunity, whether that's today or this week sometime, if you're thinking, Lord, I just want to be a part of this. I want to sow into this. And if you want to give, we would love to be able to provide Matt with an honorarium and everything that he needs in this ministry to make it flourish. And there's so much more to this. It's not a one-time thing. Matt will talk about that on Saturday, about how this can actually turn into a longer process to provide healing and restoration. And so you'll hear all about that this coming weekend. So I'm going to invite you to stand today. And I want to encourage you, whether it's e-transfer or giving or envelopes, if you would like to give an offering towards this so that maybe your life has figured it out, or maybe you're not affected by this, but you're thinking, you know what, if this is going to help someone else, then I want to be a part of contributing to that. And maybe that's you by way of giving. And so we want to give you the opportunity to do that. And there's all kinds of ways that you can visit our website, e-transfer, envelopes, etc. Let's pray today. And then I want to encourage you to come out Friday night if that's applicable to you, and Saturday morning if that's as well. So Lord, this is all about you. And your word teaches us clearly. And sometimes we read about your word. We know it's in your word, but we don't talk about it. And Lord, we're just really talking about what, God, you've instructed us in your word to teach. And we don't pick the nice, fluffy topics that make us feel good. But Lord, we want to present your word in fullness. And your word is clear about sexual immorality and walking in purity. And God, we want to honor you. We want to honor our lives and submit to your ways. And so, Lord, we thank you. Even as it can be uncomfortable sometimes, Lord, this is all to honor you, to walk in freedom, to do life your way, a better way, the way of Jesus. And so, Lord, we just thank you again for speaking to our lives today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, Matt, you do have a table set up out there. If any of you want to know more information, there's all kinds of things that can be shared. Check that out. Some of you have kids to go get. Why don't you do that now? And we'll see you Friday night and Saturday. God bless. See you again this week. Don't forget Wednesday night's Connect Night. Come on out to that as well.